hated it. Because this is the worst. You know, when those who have power over you tries to behave as colleagues, this for me was never liberating, but even power redoubled. Because they want to retain all the power they have, but on the top of it, I prefer open authority. I hate these postmodern bosses, you know, who pretend, but we are friends, ask you about your sex life, let's go drinking. This is disgusting for me. They still have the power, but they pretend as if, you know, we are really colleagues and so on and so on. I don't buy that. Okay, my point is that this is what always fascinated me. This, how to put it, how this obscenity, the ambiguity of obscenity, on the one hand, it sustains the system, on the other hand, I'm not totally condemning it, it can play a positive role. What I'm just saying is that when you should be, when something is presented to you as, how should I put it, subversive, all these secret dirty dreams and so on, you should be very careful as to how this effectively functions. Sometimes I claim the best thing to do is not to be even more, how to put it, more Puritan than the official ideology, to stick just to the explicit rules and to ignore the implicit rules, as it were. Because this is another example that I use in my books. For example, let's imagine a nice, in the horrible sense, small city in the south of the United States, Mississippi, wherever, in the 20s, with Ku Klux Klan and so on. You had the official ideology, Christianity and so on, and then you have Ku Klux Klan, which was strictly what we call a carnivalesque transgression. Let's imagine someone who violates the explicit rules, doesn't go to church, gets drunk, and so on. He would still have been one of us. But let's imagine someone who violates the implicit rules, for example, denounces Ku Klux Klan to police, you would have been killed or at least excluded immediately. What accounts for the group identity is precisely this participation in the common transgression, how should I put it? I mean, I claim that some kind of rituals of common transgression, violating your own explicit ideology, are absolutely crucial for this. That's the true transgression. The real way to exclude yourself is to ignore or violate these implicit rules. Which brings me back to another point where one of you, he was sitting yesterday there, I don't know where he is today, was talking about Bakhtin and so on. That's the problem I have not so much with Mikhail Bakhtin, you know, the Russian guy who did not only dialogue but also this theory of carnivalesque suspension. He wrote, Bakhtin, a wonderful book also on Francois Rabelais, where he developed in detail this theory of the necessary social role of so-called carnivalesque suspension of public rules. You know, the orgies, rules suspended, king is a beggar, beggar is a king, and so on and so on. Where I disagree, again, not so much with Bakhtin as with some of his followers, I disagree with those who claim that there is any kind of liberating dimension in this carnival. My proof is here, empirical even. Maybe you heard about him. I don't agree with him theoretically, but he's an intelligent guy. Boris Groys, the Russian art theorist who worked for a long time in Germany. Now he tries to penetrate the United States. He told me that he got contact with some guys in Russia who have access to Mikhail Bakhtin archives. Mikhail Bakhtin was writing his work when he was exiled to Kazan, I think. That's how he survived the Stalinist purges. Okay, the point is that it's clear from the manuscripts that the true model for carnival for Bakhtin were Stalinist purges. You know, it's because there was an element of madness in them. You know, today you are the king, member of Politburo, tomorrow you are English spy, and so on. So the suggestion is that one way to read the figure, interpret the figure of Stalin is that kind of, how should I put it, a king of the carnival, the guy who who runs this show where your faith could be up and down and so on and so on. So again, also I intended to read in this way the Ku Klux Klan. I mean, wasn't, or to be very brutal, to refer more to contemporary experience, if you, a couple of boys, get drunk and rape a couple of girls in a gangbang, I mean, if there ever was a carnival, this is a carnival. I hope you got my point. I'm not justifying the rape, on the opposite. I'm saying that I don't really believe in this, how should I call it, liberating power of carnival. It's very ambiguous thing. Adorno wrote some very good analysis where he interpreted even the Nazi pogroms and so on as some kind of a carnivalesque suspension of order and so on. So again, let's not fall too quickly into this celebrating, oh, that wonderful moment of liberation, carnival, no rules, up, down, down, up. No, I claim that every power needs some kind of carnival, some kind of carnivalesque. Yes,
I think was going to mention that I believe in dialogism because I think it situates the conversation interpersonally. I believe in it as a method more than a conclusion. I'm not sure I would subscribe to everything that he said, but I think he has an interesting method of creating social space. How he imagines culture, how he imagines the creation of self through the interlocutor. The self is defined through the interlocution.
Yeah, but how do you apply this to... there must be a connection. How... Okay, to put it in very simplistic terms, Bakhtin did two great things. A, all this idea of dialogic, well, the big author of reference was Dostoevsky, no? And then Carnival, where the big reference was Rabelais. How do you... Okay, I can well see the link, because it's clear that there are those intense moments of dialogue in Dostoevsky novels. For example, you know, the famous scene at the end of the first part of The Idiot, where Prince, or who does it, throws money into the fire and so on, which have this kind of carnivalesque suspension of rules dimension. But nonetheless, it's not totally clear to me how the two are linked. What I'm saying, again, I agree with Bakhtin. I'm just saying that sometimes we read Bakhtin in a well-to-simplified way as simply celebrating, oh my God, carnival. We should just be aware that how should I put it, Auschwitz was also, for Nazis, in a way, literally. My God, if you read Levy, it's clear that it was also, in a very obscene way, a carnivalesque place. A place where rules were suspended, you were allowed to enact your sorry.
To support your point, there's a disturbing, well, strange book called This Way for the Gas, Ladies and Gentlemen, by Tadeusz Bronowski.
Ah, I know and I agree totally with you. Even let's make a step further here. What always intrigued me, and yeah, I know you are then. I know. I want just to finish my narcissistic trip. Then you are. This is what intrigued me also. Why is it almost impossible to do a good serious tragedy about Holocaust? Why are all movies about Holocaust, which are at least tolerable comedies? I think there is a necessity in it. I will not make tasteless. I will legitimize myself. I saw this theory in Jerusalem, in a big public talk where in first row, I remember there were old ladies with numbers here sitting, and they agreed with me. The point is that to make a tragedy, you know, how should I put it? Tragedy is not when things are really horrible. Tragedy is always only possible when you remain within a certain limits of decency. How should I, you know? In order to retain your tragic dignity, the humiliation must not be total. Like, if you cannot imagine in Auschwitz, okay, you can.